Good evening. We are all horribly familiar with those images out of Africa that record the misery of mass starvation. Drought and famine, poverty, disease, no food, no shelter, exhausted mothers, sick children, dying babies. This programme, however, is not about drought or famine or poverty or disease, but it is about hunger, hunger as a weapon of war. For our report tonight, a This Week team has been behind the lines on both sides of a bitter civil war in a tormented part of Africa. The country is Sudan, where government forces are fighting in the south against a guerrilla army that now controls vast tracts of territory and has laid siege to the city of Juba. It's from a rebel stronghold at Narus, some 150 miles from the southern capital, that Peter Gill begins this report.
Disease and hunger, twin aspects of an African tragedy. A French volunteer doctor examines a woman left for dead on the outskirts of her village. A life wasted at little more than 40. The queue for help, men and women, is a long one. But it's the children who are the most vulnerable. The world outside shows it cares. On a life-giving 2,300 calories a day. These are the child survivors of a measles epidemic, of gastroenteritis. Conflict there is, even over the food. For several weeks, there's been no distribution of Red Cross grain to families in the camp. The sacks are full, but hungry people are going without. The Red Cross want to distribute, but on terms of strict need and to civilians only. There are others around who may be less scrupulous. The Sudan People's Liberation Army, the SPLA. Some 20,000 men under arms in the bush, unpaid volunteers living off the land and not notably hungry. This SPLA unit controls the famine relief camp at Narus. And they say that their people, not the Red Cross, should distribute the grain. The Red Cross fear that the food might not then go to the starving. Like armies elsewhere, African rebels also tend to march on their stomachs. The result, a diplomatic stalemate between Red Cross and rebels, and in between, people going hungry. The only practicable route from Khartoum to the main government stronghold of Juba is by air. Civilian flights over the south have virtually stopped. The planes that do go fly military brass in preference to food. 8,000 feet over Juba Airport, there are potential hazards here. The rebel SPLA has anti-aircraft weapons, including heat-seeking missiles. The pilot makes a steep approach. Rebels claim to have shot down 23 Sudanese military aircraft already. The plane was bringing the new chief of staff on a familiarization tour of his southern garrisons. Major General Abdelazim has military problems on his mind. Disrupted supply lines, poor morale among his troops. Food for civilians comes a poor second.
Food is a necessity and it must go to the population. But it must be under my control or the army control or the government control.
Military interests confront humanity on the government side too. These are child refugees of the Southern War, driven into Juba not by hunger, but by the fighting. Conflict, not drought, has turned these children into destitutes. The feeding center is run by Oxfam.
Odile, this child is obviously badly malnourished. How old is the child?
The child is probably around 1 year.
And you have others here who are also very badly malnourished.
Yeah, we have some others. This one.
Will they get better? Will these children get better?
We hope so. If the mothers bring the children every day, if the children don't get badly infected, then they have to improve. I mean, they should improve, yeah, definitely.
But there's a bigger if in Juba. What if the food runs out? When we filmed last month, there were 3 weeks' supply of children's food in stock. For adults, the cupboard was almost bare. Oxfam had bought these beans on the local market to distribute in their camp, but that was all. The war had stopped outside relief reaching Juba, and 25 tons of food, not just a few local beans, are needed every day to feed Juba's 50,000 war-displaced peoples.
Our critical situation now is the lack of food and fuel. And so we do not know what we have at hand. And maybe we would ask...
In Juba, Oxfam heads CART, standing for the Combined Agencies Relief Team.
Maybe to distribute the food.
Well, basically, the food in store today is zero. We have distributed all the food we had up to last week. Last week, we distributed the last 172 tons of food. And this week, we are a little bit okay. And next week, we have nothing.
Tribal divisions have been exacerbated and exploited in this war. It's no longer just a north-south conflict, but southerner pitted against southerner. The government gave weapons to this tribe, but the rebel SPLA and their tribal allies proved too strong.
They killed us, and then we ran here, and then they burned our houses and killed our women and children, even people, all.
James, what about your crops and what about all the food back in your community?
The food has been taken by Spele for us with the cows and goat and home affairs, taken all.
They have taken what? Home utensils, they've taken all your animals and taken them away?
Cow, goat, and grains, beans, and so on, so on.
In the war-torn countryside from which James and his community fled, government troops rarely venture far. This convoy took 3 days to organize because the Sudanese army is desperately short of fuel. Anxiety about rebel activity, particularly rebel-laid landmines, led to frequent stops and inquiries of villagers about the road ahead. Not that bows and arrows are much reassurance against landmines. On this road out of Juba, government convoys can travel less than 20 miles. A bridge destroyed by SPLA rebels prevents further progress. Among our army escorts, there's some relief that they can start packing up, turning around, and heading for the safety of Juba and the barracks. All around them, further evidence of the war. Empty homesteads, deserted farmyards, untended family graves. The current fighting in southern Sudan began with an army mutiny 3 years ago. Since then, its impact on the civilian population has become steadily more pervasive. Crops abandoned, animals stolen, whole communities driven from their homes into destitution. A land of plenty has been turned into a land of hunger. Worse still, that hunger has now become a principal weapon in the war. Like other towns in southern Sudan, Juba is dependent on outside supplies to maintain its displaced population. But guerrilla activity has now spread throughout southern Sudan, and already this year, river transport along the Nile has been cut, so food supplies are held up in Khartoum. Food stockpiled in Uganda can't get through because of fighting on both sides of the border. And now the last remaining road route from Zaire is threatened.
You don't know how desperate everybody felt here, how frustrated we felt. 2 hours flying from this place here, people were reported close to starvation. 1 year after Ethiopia, after what we all saw in Kore Mbati, and we're sitting here making contingency planning and thinking, what can we do? Nothing. The roads blocked, the railways blocked, the river blocked, the airports closed, the airspace closed. We had to do something, and that was the spirit of Rainbow.
SPLA commanders in the bush, just like government commanders in the towns, are convinced that any food to the other side will strengthen its capacity to fight. The United Nations World Food Programme tried to get both sides to accept food supplies for the hungry. But the government refused to allow food into rebel areas, so the rebel threat to shoot down relief aircraft still stands. How do you justify the distress that your tactics are causing those civilians?
It is not our tactics that are causing anything to these civilians. We have said when we were talking with the World Food Programme, who came to us and said that there are people who are suffering. We said, yes, there are people who are suffering. There are people who are suffering in the countryside. There are people, few as they are, we are also concerned about them because they are part and parcel of the Sudanese people for whom we have taken up arms. So we made a deal. We said that we will allow food to go to genuinely needy people in government-controlled towns. This is unprecedented for a guerrilla movement to say they will let food go to government-controlled towns.
But there were conditions, weren't there, Colonel, because you insisted on food being brought to rebel areas as well, your own liberated areas.
That's not a condition. This is justice. You cannot ask me to let food go to needy people in government-controlled areas and deny food to needy people in SPLA-controlled areas. It is inconsistent. It is unfair. So to be fair, we say, there are people, and let us say, let us agree on this. It is a fact. I'm not making it up. There are needy people in the countryside. There are needy people in government-controlled towns. Let us provide food to both.
But I still ask you to justify the threat to shoot down an aircraft when that aircraft was taking relief supplies that were going to be distributed by international relief organizations and not by the government.
I think the justification is reciprocal between us in the SPLA and the government in Khartoum. We did not start it. We started it with goodwill. We said let food be given to both sides. The government in Khartoum says no, only to one side. And then people want to crucify us for saying what is correct, that food should go to both sides.
But Colonel, if such conditions are not met, does your threat to shoot down aircraft not responding to those...
If these conditions are not met, then there is a reason why they are not met. Something is being hidden. What is it that is being hidden? We don't know. So a plane that goes to Wau purporting to be carrying relief supplies could be carrying something else.
In Khartoum, the United Nations still struggled to put humanity before politics.
Well, I was sad, but I was not surprised. There are politics, and there is many reasons for which one should make declarations such that one, like propaganda, and his own, I would say, principle of wanting to show that he controls the airspace. But I was surprised, because I must tell you, it's surprised in other way, because after all, John Garang is claiming to fight for the well-being of southerners. Well, we were going to try to bring food to children, southern children, in the south, and we were going to guarantee, as we are, that they will go to civilians, carried by civilians. Well, that didn't make much sense to me. That's why I decided that we should go ahead anyway.
The siege is lifted. On a Sunday morning in Juba, a French cargo plane ignores the threat of missiles to bring 32 tons of food to children in the south. By scouring the charter market, the United Nations had found a company that carried permanent war risk insurance, and more to the point, a crew willing to take the gamble. For 3 hectic days, 6 flights, there was a rainbow in Juba. At the end of that rainbow, almost 200 tons of food. But sieges can be lifted without there being long-term relief in sight. 50,000 displaced people eat 200 tons of food in little more than a week. There are more immediate questions too. Who will control distribution of the food that has arrived? How can relief agencies caught up in a civil war resist military pressure to give food to one side and deny it to the other? Does the government seek to prevent food getting through to people who are not on their side?
Oh, yes, indeed. It's impossible for us, under present circumstances, to distribute food to areas which are said to be in dispute. In other words, areas that effectively are being fought over. Sadly, we're unable to get, therefore, to the vast majority of the people who really are in need in southern Sudan at the moment.
But there's an authentic security problem there. It's not simply the government preventing you feeding these starving people, is it?
Well, there is a security problem, but it's not a problem which in other places at other times has been impossible to overcome.
Sudan's military governor in Juba is outraged at such talk of neutrality among the agencies.
They're, say, working with us and doing humanitarian work and so forth, and we are supposed to be blind about their work and their operations. This just can't happen. We must be in control of it, not control of food or so, but we must know, we must target for where these things should go. We must protect them, because...
But they say they don't want to be protected, General.
What is the meaning of this?
They say...
What is the meaning of this? Well, when they don't want to be protected, what is the meaning of it? Well, at the same time, there is rebellion, as they claim. What is the meaning of it?
They say that by being protected by the Sudanese military, they are compromised in their operations.
This sort of philosophy doesn't hold with me, or doesn't hold with us at the present moment.
They say they are trying to reach people on whichever side of the conflict.
How do they know? How do they know? After all, they came from other countries, from Europe, US, and so forth. How do they know this situation here? We know it better. We know it better. We worked on this country, we use our feet, and we look face to face with what is bad. How could they just claim that they are taking it to pick this and all this sort of stuff? How do they come?
Well, they say they can judge by reaching ordinary civilians in the villages on whichever side.
They even do not know who are ordinary civilians. They don't know this. We know this. We say, you bring the things, we will let you know who are the ordinary civilians. We know it, as the people responsible and as the government of the Sudan. We know the civilians, we know the normal people, we know the villages, we know the tracks and paths. We know where the rebels are, who they are, we know them.
These are so-called rebel civilians at the rebel famine camp in Narus. Yet they are no more favored by their rebel protectors than civilians on the government side or those caught in between. The politics of food distribution apply just as rigorously here. Food still awaits distribution because the rebels want their own relief agency, the SRRA, to take charge.
Chiefs have to assure that all the food is well protected.
At meetings in the camp, the Red Cross field delegate explains to tribal leaders why he won't distribute food without proper guarantees. It's an argument that means little to a hungry community that can see the food. More pressure is applied. Women and children stage a demonstration in the Red Cross compound. Their chant, "Why bring the food if we can't eat it?" Rebel officers remain out of sight. They say they wouldn't exclude the Red Cross entirely from food distribution to civilians.
They are supposed to receive it from the international agencies, and the agencies can be in the place where it is being received so that they see it physically going to the population. They will have to monitor it to see how much this is being used so that there is accountability. We don't want to tell to the agencies that keep away and we do it without them, or the SSR has to do the job. No, this is what we mean. We mean that the physical distribution to the population has to be handled by somebody who knows the mentality of the people who is dealing with them.
Certainly it seems to the outsider that in this conflict on both sides, it is the civil population that gets hurt. It's the civil population that ends up hungry.
This is natural. In any fighting area, the civil population is a part of the war, and that's definitely suffer. You can't rule it out. It's not only in the south. In any place where there is war, the civil population does get away with it. They are involved, they are caught up. This way, the international agencies are to relieve them.
General, are you using starvation, using hunger, using food as a weapon against the rebels in this conflict and against those who find themselves in rebel areas?
I think that I can simply tell you this, that we are not using starvation against those who happen to be in the rebel areas. Never at all. But the secret happen to be that situation or that area has been infested by rebels, or the rebels are operating in it. And whoever is in that area, that is just a calamity. It's outside anybody thinking.
Do you think that you have got this neutrality established to your satisfaction in this conflict by operating on this side?
Far from it. At the moment, at best, we are managing to reach perhaps 15% of the total population of need in southern Sudan. There's an enormous challenge still faces us, therefore, to try and reach all of the people in southern Sudan.
Prospects for that get worse, not better. In the short term, some improvements. The Red Cross has resumed food distribution in Nowruz. And in Juba, just as the food ran out again, a few more relief flights. Bright spots in the gloom. But the war intensifies. More productive people are displaced, and long-term relief is still not secure. In the countryside, the human cost is incalculable and growing. Another abandoned village, this one in a rebel-controlled area. What Africa needs, more than Western relief food, more than Western charity, is peace. And in southern Sudan, as in so many other African bush wars, peace today is a very distant prospect.
Peter Gill reporting from southern Sudan, where the latest information is that for the moment at least, food is getting into the stricken area, both by air and by road. But how many of the victims will be reached and for how long the corridors stay open is a matter of great uncertainty. And now, if I may, to what for all of us on this week has overshadowed the making of that report. The team had finished filming and was on its way out of the rebel area on the route home. They were driving along a dirt road when one of their vehicles was blown up by a landmine. Alan Stewart, the producer, was killed in the explosion. He was 35 years old. Alan would have been the first to say that the risk of getting killed goes with the job, which is true, but does nothing to ease the shock and the sense of loss that his colleagues and friends here now feel. Alan had been a member of the current affairs team at Thames from the start of his career in television. The film that you've just seen was the 41st that he had produced for this department. Peter Gill, the reporter on that film, worked with Alan on many occasions.
From the moment Alan bounded into Khartoum at the beginning of our work on that film, nothing mattered more to him than getting the story done and done properly. It was always like that with Alan, an energy and enthusiasm for the work in hand that was cheerful but quite unrelenting. Even before the accident, our Sudanese trip had proved exceptionally arduous. Long journeys through the bush and no comforts at all at the other end. From Alan, of course, not a whisper of complaint. This was all incidental to bringing back a story that he knew, as we all knew, to be important. Just a few minutes before the explosion, we stopped to have this group photograph taken with our rebel escorts. Barring another 8 hours on the road, the work was done, the filming complete. You can almost see Alan's gaze beginning to search for the next story. He would have wanted to start on that tomorrow morning, if at all possible. It is that quality of commitment, that exceptional enthusiasm for the work, which we have lost.